waters all around, but here I am on solid ground as you reach down to me. And if you were on my side, whom shall I fear? And I know the maker of the wind, the master of the waves, the giver of my sin. And I know the one who holds my hope, so I won't be afraid when storms come blowing in. I know the maker of the wind. When trouble finds me, sneaks up behind me, rips me up and it makes me fall. But when I'm broken, then you remind me that you've overcome it all. And if you were on my side, whom shall I fear? And I know the maker of the wind, the master.
Is it safe?
Yes.
Are you sure? Because I'm over 60.
I promise you, Dennis, I'm safe.
Oh, by the way, Jesus loves you. Okay. Hey there, church family, isolated, socially distanced church family. Just want to welcome you to Fern Creek Christian Church. If it's your first time here, please fill out this card. It's got the information on the front, and then you can put prayer requests on the backside. Also, if you've seen these baby bottles around, fill them up with your change and bring them back by July 26th. And that'll be the time we collect them up. They're for Beside You Pregnancy Life Skills Center. So it's going to be a great thing to help out that. And we want to thank all of you that gave blood. That was a big help. You really made a difference. Our offering, we encourage you again to give online. But there are envelopes in the back of the pews in the sanctuary. And just want to let you know, your generosity allows us to be able to help and bless a lot of people out there. So please keep doing that. And now let's get ready to worship.
To worship! That's how I would have done it. But Dennis is really good at that. If you ever just need to smile, just have a conversation with Dennis Hook. He'll make you smile in a heartbeat. Man, we're glad you're here with us to worship, and we're going to start doing this in every service each week now, where we just take some time at the beginning instead of jumping right in and being like, oh, let's sing some songs and wake up as we sing. Let's take some time now to get our hearts and our minds ready before worship. And I actually have another story for you all. I love stories. Anybody love stories, like sitting around a campfire telling stories? That's like my dream way to spend my night. Like if I had my dream day, I would see UK win the national championship, and then blah, 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 and then worship Jesus, and then yeah. Wow. And then tell some stories at night. That would be my dream day. Anyways, that had nothing to do with what I was gonna say. Sorry, I had a lot of coffee. It's that cold brew, man. Anyways, so I made a friend this week. I'm so sorry. His name, you guys might know him. His name's Ben Lakin. And I think he used to work here. But he's a worship leader up in Indianapolis now. And I've never met the guy, but he's turned into this huge blessing in my life. He now calls me like once a week. And it's like, hey, how you doing? I need that, man. And so I'm super thankful for him. And we were talking, and he understands like a lot of the worship leader probs, hashtag worship leader probs things, you know, just all the difficulties of being a worship leader. And so we get to share stories and get to ask him, hey, how'd you do that live stream or whatever. And we were talking this week, and I have a confession, I have to be honest with you. And so I was talking to him, and I said, you know, sometimes I get really frustrated. I'm like up there leading worship, I'm like singing this, man, I'm like going for it, and then I look out and like, so sometimes I see that and I'm like, oh man, I get so frustrated. And I said something to him I really regret, and I have to share it with you. I said to him, I was like, you know, I just wish people would leave their problems out there and just come in here and worship. You know, I wish people could just leave everything out there so that they could come in here and be energetic and joyful. And I regret saying that so much. And I have to confess that to you. That's been really burdening me this weekend. I'm like, no, Matt, you are so wrong. This is the place where you should bring your burdens. This is the place where you should bring your baggage. This is the place where you should bring your feelings and your emotions and lay them before God in worship. It's those burdens that help us open up in worship and to ask for God's mercy and to ask for His grace as we worship. And so that's the mood I'm in this morning is, wow, I was so wrong. And I needed to realize that. And I do. And so I hope that encourages you. I hope that if you came in here with something on your heart, with something weighing on your soul, that you would just lift it up in worship today. I'm going to sing this bridge of a song we all know super, super well. We've sung it in here a few times. And whenever you feel ready, whenever you feel ready, it doesn't have to be right away, but then would you just stand and join me in singing at this message I think we all need to hear? Even when I don't see it, you work. Even when I don't feel it, you work. And you never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you work. Even when I don't feel it, you work. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working, yeah. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working, yeah. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Oh, you are Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Oh. God, you are a light in the darkness. Whatever we came in here feeling this morning, we know we can lift it and be honest and vulnerable and authentic and open before you. Would you bring us joy in the midst of our worship? Not because we left everything at the door, but because we brought our burdens and our pains and our feelings before you. And we let it out in worship. May you get glory this morning. It's in your name we pray. Let's worship this morning. So come now, Lord, like never. about the breakthrough that's coming. And I know breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. Yeah. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. Yeah. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith, I see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. Yeah. I know breakthrough is coming. By faith, see a miracle. My God made me a promise and it won't stop now. Yeah. Whoa. Sing that chorus one more time with me. Your presence is an open door. We want you, Lord, like never before. We want you. Your presence is an open door. So come now, Lord, like never before. We want you. Let's keep worshiping. There is no fear, 'cause I believe. There is no doubt, 'cause I have seen. Your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. I have a hope found in your name. I have a strength found in your grace. Your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. Come on, sing this out. Make way through the waters, walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dry bones to life. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. I believe in you, God, I believe in you. Release your love inside of me. Unleash your power for all to see. Spirit, come and fall on us over and over. Oh Lord, make way through the waters, walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dry bones to life. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think. Lord, you will never fail. Your name is powerful, your word's unstoppable. All things are possible in you. Amen. Come on. God of exceedingly, God of abundantly, more than we ask or think. Lord, you will never fail. Your name is powerful, your word's unstoppable.
all things are possible in you. Make way to the waters.
Faithfulness in this time. There's so much going on, and there's so many emotions and feelings that we're feeling, and all these opinions, but God, we just lay it all before you, and we ask you for your mercy and your grace, and we know that even when we don't see it, you're working, that your promises still stand. Help us to trust your faithfulness, and may that lead us to a greater understanding of what joy really means. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You guys can take a seat. We're going to enter into our time of communion together, but before we take communion, I want to share this scripture with you that struck me, because we're talking about, we're in the series Peeled, and we're talking about fruit of the Spirit, and we're talking about joy this week. And in my Bible reading, I came across John 16. I was like, oh, look at that title. I love that the sections have titles. It's so helpful for me, because I'm not the smartest guy in the room. I'm like, oh, so that's what he's talking about. Okay, cool. The title is Sadness Will Be Turned to Joy. I was like, huh, that sounds cool. And so Jesus is talking to his disciples, and I was like, oh my gosh, I feel like Jesus is saying that to me right there. So let me read it for you. This is verse 22 in John 16. He says to his disciples, "So you have sorrow now, but I will see you again. Then you will rejoice, and no one can rob you of that joy. At that time, you won't need to ask me for anything. I tell you the truth, you will ask the Father directly, and he will grant your request because you use my name. You haven't done this before. Ask using my name, and you will receive, and you will have abundant joy." And so in this time of communion, I just hope that you take this time and use it to ask God for what you feel like you need. In Jesus' name, to just ask for forgiveness, ask for grace, to ask for more peace, for more joy, whatever it is. Take these next 3 minutes just to reflect and to pray and to ask the Father what you need. love, joy, peace, patience and kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience and kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Fruit of the Spirit, fruit of the Spirit.
Now, if that doesn't bring a little joy to your life, I don't know what will. Hey, it's good to be together. Whether you're watching on our online campus or whether you're here in person, it's good to be in the house of the Lord. Hey, we are in week two of a brand new series that we're calling Peeled. And we're spending several weeks going through what's known as the fruit of the Holy Spirit, found in Galatians chapter 5. Now, remember, last week we talked about a couple of things as kind of an intro, and then we talked about the fruit of or the characteristic of love. The first thing I wanted you to remember was this is the fruit, singular, fruit of the Holy Spirit, not fruits. So there's not nine different ones where we can pick and choose. No, there's one fruit, and it's just being described with nine different characteristics. Second thing I want you to remember is the premise of the series. We're calling the series Peeled. Very important that you understand that, that you hang on to that, because when life peels us apart, when we're physically, well, when we're emotionally, mentally, or spiritually opened up in life, when things don't go our way, when we don't get what we want, when we're up against something big, when we're peeled, the Bible says what ought to come out are these things: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are the things that ought to be leaking out of our life when we're peeled apart. Now, today we want to focus on the second characteristic of the fruit of the Holy Spirit, which is joy. Joy. Now, when I think about joy, I think about the first mission trip I ever led. How many of you have been on a mission trip? Can I see your hands if you've ever been on a mission trip? All right. First one I ever led, I took a group of high school students to Jamaica, Mon. That's a pretty tough place to go, right? Well, we went to do a vacation Bible school. And I don't remember a lot. You know, it's been a lot of years ago, but I remember two things that I'll never forget. One was every day these 10-year-old little girls would walk into the church, and they were just covered with sweat. Now, it was hot in Jamaica, but not in the morning. And so they would come in and they would just ask you for a cup of water. And so we began to, you know, to kind of talk about their story. And what I found out was they walked 4 miles every day. That's why they were sweating. They walked 4 miles just to come to our vacation Bible school. And I tell you, they just sat there, not one complaint about the walk, not one complaint about being hot, beautiful smiles, just exhibiting this overflow of joy. And I remember that. Second thing I remember was the worship in Jamaica. Now, I grew up in the Catholic Church. We were very high church, very liturgical. The church that I was serving at the time, we had the second largest pipe organ in the state of Ohio. Ooh, so that was very liturgical, very high church as well. The worship in Jamaica was a little different. It was reggae, right? So the steel drums, the steel drums started going, the keys started playing, the women started swaying, the men started clapping. And I remember the song that started worship. I've never heard it. I mean, this is like 25, 26 years ago. Never heard the song since. But it had such a profound impact on me that I'll never forget it till the day I die. This is the song that opened worship. J-O-Y, joy. Joy in the Lord. J-O-Y, joy. Joy in the Holy Ghost. Don't let nobody steal your joy. Don't let nobody steal your joy. Don't let nobody steal your joy. Joy in the Lord. And then they all went, ay, 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 ay. And then a dance party broke out in the church. They were laughing and clapping. And then, I mean, I'm just kind of taking it all in. And then the mamas of the church saw me. And the mamas knew that I was the leader of the group. So the mamas came and they dragged me up to the front of the church. As we sang it again, I joined their dance party. So I'm dancing and I'm bouncing and they're laughing because I can't dance at all, right? And it was one of these moments where I just thought, Lord, what are you showing me? These 2 10-year-old girls who had to walk 4 miles to VBS, and I sometimes complain about having to drive 10 minutes. And this church of people, these brothers and sisters who hardly have anything, but they have this abundance of joy. God, teach me to have this joy. And it's one thing to read about joy. It's one thing to sing about joy. It's another thing to have it. So I want to ask you this morning, do you have it? Do you have this joy of the Lord? That's what we're going to go, because the Bible says you ought to. The Bible says you need to. The Bible says if you're connected to Jesus, the natural outpouring is joy. I mean, that's what happens. If you're connected to him, joy ought to be flowing in your life. Now, I'm not talking, are you happy? There's a big difference between happiness and joy. Happiness, I'm not saying, are you happy? Happiness depends upon what happens. You know, I mean, like, if your bank account is good and you're physically healthy and you have the home that you're living in and you find $20 in the laundry, someone bakes you a coconut cream pie, you know, if those externals are good, then you are happy, because happiness depends on what happens. But then what happens when the externals go south? What happens when the things around you don't go like you want? I read about a man who was jogging in the park one day, and as he was jogging, he noticed this elderly man sitting on a bench just weeping uncontrollably. So he stopped and he walked over and he said, "Hey, what seems to be the problem?" And between sobs, the old man said, "I'm married to a 28-year-old supermodel, and she greets me every day at the door with a martini, and she cooks me this gourmet meal, and she cleans up. I never have to clean. She tells me how lucky it is that she's married to someone like me, and she puts ESPN on for me every night, and she rubs my feet before I go to bed." Some of you are saying, "Woo," right? And the guy said, "Well, that sounds awesome. Why are you crying? Why are you so sad?" And in between sobs, the guy said, "Because I forgot where I live. I can't remember where I live," right? And it was one of those moments where, you know, it's like happiness depends on where you live. Joy doesn't depend on where you live. Joy doesn't depend on what's going on around you. Happiness comes from the outside in. Joy comes from the inside out. Happiness is temporary. It can change. Joy is eternal, and it doesn't go away. Let me show you what joy is all about. One of my favorite passages of all the Bible about joy. Look at Habakkuk chapter 3. "Even though the fig trees have no blossoms, and there are no grapes on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns are empty, yet I will," what's the next word? "Rejoice. I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be," what's the next word? "Joyful in the God of my salvation." That's it. Even though the externals, even though everything around me is going to pot, I still have joy. Now remember, you can't just white knuckle this. You can't just go, "Well, I gotta buck up and I gotta just get more joy and I gotta study more and I gotta pray more and I gotta create more joy in my life." No, remember what Jesus said. Stay connected to me. Keep our relationship healthy and joy will flow. The problem with joy is you have an enemy. You and I have an enemy. There's a parasite, there's a disease, there's a leech that attaches itself to the vine. And is there somebody out there trying to steal your joy? Yes, the enemy. And so if you and I don't have this joy flowing in our life, we ought to check the vine. We ought to check, all right, is there an issue in my life? Is there a parasite in my life? Is there a disease that's robbing me of what ought to naturally be taking place if I stay connected with Jesus? So I want to remind you today, again, this isn't a list where I'm going to give you 3 things to do so you can go get some joy. No. No, I just want to remind you of 3 things that you have. And when you and I focus on these three things that we have, I think joy will be overflowing in our life. So here's the first thing I want to remind you. I've got joy this morning because my past is forgiven. Amen? Man, I've got joy because my past is forgiven. Do you know the name Simon Kenton? Does that, he's a pioneer from a long time ago. So Simon Kenton was 16 when he got into a fight over a girl. Well, he beat the guy up so bad he thought he died. So he fled. He lived as an outlaw. The guy got better, but Simon thought he had died. So for the next 31 years, he lived in, changed his name, tried to create a new identity, became a frontiersman. He was caught by the Indians, and he had to run the quarter-mile gauntlet 9 separate times, but he survived it. Many people would die just once. He was abused. He once saved the life of Daniel Boone. He's a very interesting man. But Simon and his wife Elizabeth went to Ohio in 1808, and while they were up in Ohio, he came upon a camp meeting, a revival meeting, and he and his wife stayed for several days listening to the preacher and these hundreds of people who were worshiping Jesus. And after one of the sermons, one of the nights of worship, he asked the preacher if the preacher would take a walk with him into the woods. And as they got away from everybody, Simon Kenton turned to the preacher and he said, "Listen, I'm going to share with you some things that I hope you will keep private. I hope you will never tell anyone." And the preacher said, "Well, if it's only stuff that has to relate to you and me, then I pledge my secrecy." So Simon Kenton, fully aware that the pastor would be good to his word, he just unloaded. And he began to talk about his life of sin, how he had done horrible things, how he had abused different people, how he had killed several men. And he began to break down, saying, "I don't think God could ever have mercy on someone like me. I hear you sing the songs, and I hear the people receive the word, but I just don't think God could ever do that for someone like me." And the preacher spoke to him privately about the grace and the love of Jesus, and both men dropped to their knees, and the preacher prayed that God's mercy and grace would wash over Simon Kenton. And something happened in that prayer to such a degree that after the prayer, Simon Kenton jumped up to his feet and began to yell with joy and went running back into the camp. And as the people of the camp gathered around him, he began to just tell them, he said, at last God has forgiven me. At last his grace is on me. I can finally join the family of God. And Reverend Maxie strolled in a few minutes later. And as he listened, he said, "Simon, I thought you and I were going to keep this matter private." And Simon Kenton shook his head and said, No, I feel it's too glorious for that. If all the world were here, I would tell the world of the mercy and the goodness of God." There was a man who fully understood what it was like to have his past wiped clean. Now listen, no one had to tell me, no one had to lecture me about how sinful I was when I came to Jesus. I knew it, right? I had said things, thought things, done things that had totally cut me off from a holy, righteous God. Now, before you think I was a grave sinner, I thought I was a partial sinner. My sins were trivial and cute. Right? Like I wasn't like this guy, but yeah, I might have said something or thought something. But I was told that the Bible says, man, one sin rots you to the core. One sin contaminates you from a holy God. One sin separates you from ever. And then the good news of the gospel is that God loved me so much, he sent his one and only son, that no matter how deep, how wide, how long my sin was, that Jesus died on the cross and his blood covered my sin. And I began to hear the words of David when David said in Psalm 32, "Oh, what joy for those whose disobedience is forgiven, whose sin is put out of sight. Yes, what joy for those whose record the Lord has cleared of guilt." So I'm just wondering, is there anybody here today who knows how wonderful it is to be forgiven? Man. Yeah. It's like you're on death row. You were walking towards that death chamber, and then the call came and someone said no. Man, free that man. I've been acquitted. I've been set free from an eternal destiny separated from God. I've been saved from the righteous wrath of God. And the words that overwhelm my soul this morning are the words of Horatio Spafford. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not a part, but the whole, was nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. And that's why I've got joy this morning. The world didn't give that to me. The world can't take that away. That is not temporarily lived. That is eternally celebrated. So, man, I've got joy this morning based upon, man, I've been set free from a sinful past. But it goes more than that. It goes beyond that. I've also got joy because my present is an adventure. My past has been forgiven, but my present is this epic adventure. When you read the scripture, you find something very interesting. When people encounter God, when people run into Jesus, when they have this meeting, most times, man, their life changes. Their life was lived one way, they met God, they met Jesus, and now their life turned, and it now is totally lived a different way. Very often, God the Father, Jesus the Son would call people, right? God said to Abraham, follow me. God said to Moses, I've got a job for you. God said to Noah, I need you to build an ark. Jesus said to James and John, drop your nets and come with me. Jesus said to Paul, it is me that you're crucifying, and I've got another plan for your life. When you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, man, you begin the greatest adventure you will ever know this side of heaven. And here's why. Because before you came to know Jesus, you used to live for yourself. Now you're going to live for him. You used to take shortcuts, and now, man, oftentimes you're taking the long way home. You used to be the driver. Now you're the passenger. Now, you know how scary it can be, depending on who's driving, to be a passenger, don't you? If you ever go to teach your teenagers how to drive, you know that little handlebar right there on the side? You know it's a little scary turning the wheel over to someone else. Well, it happened to a car salesman in a 2013 Pepsi commercial. Pepsi hired NASCAR champion Jeff Gordon to pull the prank of a lifetime. If you think turning the controls over to someone else, being the passenger, is an easy thing, watch this car salesman get faked and pranked by Jeff Gordon. Take a look at this.
So I was thinking a little more age on me, some wrinkles, a little dorky, maybe some facial hair. It was somebody that I can pull off a fun prank with.
Let's go have some fun.
My good friends at Pepsi Max have hooked us up with this cool cam. So these are the glasses cam to show you everything that I see.
How you doing?
Hello. I'm Mike.
Steve, nice to meet you. Oh, you're sort of narrow.
Oh, no. This way too much car for me.
Well, it's a lot of power, but they designed it to be very safe.
I don't know if I can handle it. I've never driven anything like this before.
Well, I tell you what, I think a way to really make you feel comfortable would be to put you behind the wheel.
You're good.
What are you driving now?
Oh, just a minivan.
Oh, yeah.
What am I signing here?
You're not sure? It's just a checkout sheet for a test drive. You're not obligated to anything. It's just so we know who's out. Let's go give it a drive.
Getting a little nervous.
No, I'll be right there beside you. There are your keys, sir.
Thank you, Steve.
You'll have to unlock it, Mike.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
There we go.
Oh, yeah. What a car.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we better buckle up.
Yeah, good call. Power door locks, standard, of course.
You are liable for any damages to the vehicle, so please stop the car, or at least slow down. Slow down. You can't go through that gate, Mike.
Stop.
Watch out!
You're going to wreck this car, and you're liable for it if you wreck it. Mike, stop the car. Stop right now. Shut up here.
It's not what you think. No, it's just a prank. We're just having fun. Look, this is a camera. Here's a camera. There's cameras. Look, it was all just fun. Look, I'm Jeff Gordon. Sorry, man. Sorry.
Can we do it again?
Yeah, let's do it
again. Did you hear his last line? When he found out who it was, he said, "Do you want to do it again?" Right? You know, when you ask Jesus to come into your life and you begin this epic adventure and you move from the driver's seat to the passenger seat and Jesus starts to drive your life, you want a comfortable ride. So Jesus, take me to this kind of house, or take me to this kind of life, or take me to this kind of job. And as long as Jesus drives slow, and as long as Jesus drives where you want him to take you, life is fine. But I'm telling you this, you follow Jesus very long, and there comes a day when you wake up and all of a sudden he does a couple donuts. And then instead of going the way you want him to go, he goes somewhere else. And you begin to sit in that passenger side seat going, whoa, no. Slow down, Jesus. No. Take the car back. Take us back. You're going to be liable. You're going too fast. That curve's coming too sharp. Slow down. Hang on. And Jesus smiles and he just says, buckle up, buttercup. We're going, right? And I'm learning. I'm learning that there are things in my life that I want and places that I want to go to and things that I want to do. And what I'm learning is, man, God's in control. And I just need to sit, and instead of closing my eyes and being fearful or bitter or resentful, I just need to say, okay, you've got the wheel, let's go. Because I don't want to get to the end of my life and look back as I'm standing in front of Jesus knowing that he has been faithful and he's brought me through. I don't want to look back and go, oh, could we go back and do it again? I want to enjoy the ride now. Look at Psalm 16:11. You will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of your presence and the pleasure of living with you. Not just in eternity, but now. There is a joy. There is a joy that in this life, man, we can say, God's got it and I trust him. God's got it. And I trust him. Would you just repeat that after me? God's got it, and I trust him. Okay, let's say it like you really mean it. God's got it, and I trust him. That's how the adventure is supposed to be lived, right? Because he knows how to take the sharp turns. He knows the road ahead. He knows what's coming up. He knows how to drive my life, and he never gets lost. So when a detour comes my way, when life seems to be coming way too fast, when it goes a direction that I didn't expect it to go, when the doctor says, it's not good, I can say, God's got it, and I trust him. If you're having family dysfunction, and it's the kids or it's your parents, you can work through that and you can say, well, you know what? God's got it and I trust him. When the finances dry up, when your fiance calls off the wedding, God's got it and I trust him. When the investment goes down the tubes, if you get the coronavirus, God's got it and I trust him. Man, are my feelings going to be hurt? Yeah, probably. Am I anxious? Maybe. Is my happiness level down? Absolutely. But I hang on. Pull the seatbelt tight because I know God's got this and I can trust him. So listen, I've got joy because my past has been forgiven. I've got joy because in spite of the ride, God's got it and I trust him. And the third thing I want to remind you of is, man, I've got joy because my destination is secure. Oh, man. It just keeps getting better. I've got joy because my destination is secure. Now listen, friends, heaven, it is not a mythological place. It's not a fable. It's not a fantasy. It's not a cross my fingers and hope it's true. Man, it is the literal dwelling place of the Lord Most High. It is a place where the air we'll breathe is love and joy and peace. It's a place where beauty never fades. It's a place where the angels sing. It's a place of never-ending reunion. It's a place of no more hunger, no more sorrow, no more anger, no more pain. It's a place of exploration and travel, one wonder after another. It's a place of perfection. It's a place where we will once again walk hand in hand with God. Man, it is real. It is your home. And listen to me, when Jesus gets in your car, that's where he's driving you to. All these little things in life, college, work, career, who you marry, all those little things are just drives that gets you from here to really your real destination, which is heaven. And I want to remind you what Jesus said about your final destination, about the road trip from here to there, right? The very last night before Jesus was crucified, man, he had that last meal with his disciples. I want to remind you what he said. Look at what he said in John chapter 14. He said, "There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And when everything is," what's the next word? "Ready. When everything is ready, I will come and get you, so that you will always be with me where I am." Now, I gotta tell you, I've read that passage hundreds of times. But one day I was reading it, and my heart stopped on those four words, "when everything is ready." And I just burst out in this deep, overwhelming sense of joy. Because I want you to remember this, the day, the hour, and the second when you die has already been determined in heaven. I mean, the day, the second, and the hour when you make the final stop, as Jesus is he is going to drop you off at heaven's gate on a certain day, a certain hour, and a certain second. And that date's already set. So people get all freaked out. Well, when will I die? If you got a relative who is not doing well, when are they going to die? When everything is ready. When am I going to go meet the Lord? How? When everything is ready. When everything is ready, he will slide up to those gates, the door will open up, and you'll be escorted, man, right into the home that you've been longing for. And I've got joy knowing that my destination is secure, not because I'm a good man, not because I've lived a good life, not because I'm a preacher. I have this joy that my security is solidified because I've surrendered control of my life to him. There's a rental car company, I'm not quite sure who it is. They say if you need a rental car, we'll pick you up. No matter where you are, we'll pick you up. And that is so Jesus. That ought to be his slogan, right? Addiction Alley, man, he'll pick you up. Depression Drive, man, he'll pick you up. Broken Boulevard, he knows where that street is. Loneliness Lane, he's been there a time or two. Self-Righteous Circle, he's picked up tons of people from that location. Materialism Manor, he knows the way. No matter where you are, he can pick you up. But listen, you got to call on him. You got to whisper his name. You got to get in the car. You got to let him drive. Look at Acts chapter 4, verse 12. "There is salvation in no one else. God has given no other name under heaven by which we must be saved." I'm just here today to remind you, you can't drive yourself to heaven. No other car companies deliver to heaven. But you call on him and you give him your life. Let him unwind. Let him untangle. Let him untwist your life. And when that happens, man, you have this joy. Not happiness. You'll have this joy knowing when everything is ready, that car will slide up, the door will open, and I will be in the house of the Lord forever. So listen, I'm not giving you anything to do. You can't create joy on your own. But if you're a Christian, if you're a Christian, I want to remind you, if that connection to the vine is healthy, man, there ought to be a joy flowing through your life. A joy because you know your past is forgiven. A joy because you know my present is an amazing adventure. He's got it and I trust him. And a joy because you know when everything is ready, man, you will walk in his house forever. Now, if you're not a Christian, man, you don't have any of that. But that's available to you. And if you just give your life to Jesus and you say, you know what? Take me where I am. And he will forgive your sin. He will slide into that car and drive and he'll drop it. You've got to come. We had a baptism today between first service and second service. We had a fellow who came and said, you know what? I'm ready. I'm ready for my past to be forgiven. Ready for my present to be an adventure, and I'm ready for my future to be secure. So friends, listen, as we sing this last song, if you've never made Jesus your Lord and Savior, I'm going to be standing right under that cross. Come talk to me, and let's get you connected to the vine so that joy can flow through your life. Let me pray. Father, thanks. Thanks for reminding me that the world didn't give me any of what we just talked about. The world can't take it away. Jesus, that all comes from you. God, the joy that we've talked about this morning is not based upon what happens around me. It's based because of what you're doing in me. So no matter what, when, how, or where I'm peeled, I can leak joy. Thank you for the joy. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Together.
Around me, Jesus, my Jesus.
extravagant. It doesn't make sense. I'll never comprehend the way you love us. It's unthinkable. Only heaven knows just how far you'd go to say you love us. To say you love us. To say you love us.
This is what God's saying to you this morning. Here is all my love. It's yours, no conditions. When you pull me close, no, I won't resist it. Here is all my love. It's yours, no conditions. When you pull me close, no, I won't resist it. Here is all my love. It's yours, no conditions. When you pull me close, no, I won't resist it. 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 Only heaven knows just how far you go to say you love us. 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 It's extravagant. It doesn't make sense. I'll never comprehend the way you love us. It's unthinkable. Only heaven knows just how far you'd go to say.
Amen. Hey, has it been good to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. Amen, amen, amen. So, hey, so just wanted to, before we pray you out, just wanted to tell you thanks. This whole corona thing is something we are trying to, as a church, to wrap our hands around. And, you know, we got these three services, new service that we're going to launch on August 16th, and we keep praying and saying to the Lord, help us listen and figure out, you know, where you want us to go. And so that those three services, that new service will start on the 16th. We'll let you know if there's any other changes with programming. But I just want to tell you thanks for wearing these. I know some of you have some medical conditions that prohibit you from wearing a mask. And if that's you, I want you to know we totally understand that. But you know, I think what we're trying to do as a church is to say, hey, how can we be obedient? How can we show our community that in a non-biblical aspect, you know, this is good. This is a healthy thing to do. This is an okay thing to do. So for the next, I think it's, think that mandate was for 30 days. So for the next couple weeks, we're going to encourage you to keep wearing your mask in worship. And I just appreciate your generosity. And again, you know, I've heard horror stories from some of my colleagues who've said that people have blown up in the service when someone asked them to wear a mask. And there's been arguing and fighting and yelling. And this is one of those moments where, again, I think a lot of humility and a lot of grace and a lot of sacrifice is something that we're gonna lean on. And what the enemy meant for evil, I think, man, he can turn for our good, but we got to stay humble and we got to stay united. So just thanks. Thanks for your grace in all of this. But let me pray us out, and it's so good to see you, and we look forward to worshiping with you again. Let me pray for us. God, thanks for allowing us to be together today. It's great to worship from home, and we've got so many people, Lord, who long to be back, but because of maybe a pre-existing condition or just not ready to be back in worship yet, God, but I know they long to. And so, God, I pray for our brothers and sisters who aren't with us, that you would give them strength and health, that you would give them wisdom in knowing when to come back. And God, help us to create an environment that when people who are compromised, when people who are nervous, when they walk into the room, that God, just we could make them feel right at home. We could make them feel comfortable. And God, many of us have differing opinions and differing thoughts. But God, to be able to be part of a family who says, you know what? For the love of my family member, I'm gonna sacrifice a little bit. God, that's your people. So God, as we dismiss from this place, help us to enter into a world that's really not very joyful. They don't have what we have. So God, may that joy exude so much in our life, people would say, "What? How are you so," they're gonna use the word happy. But God, we could come right behind them and say, "Well, you know, I'm not really happy, I'm just full of joy." And joy is so much better than happiness. And let me tell you about the one who gives me that joy. So God, help us to rest in our past is forgiven. Today is an adventure, and we long for that day when you're going to drive us home. Our security is set. Thanks for those things that bring us joy. Pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, ushers, come on up.